Welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on Atlas and Axis. The vertebral column includes around 33 vertebrae, and they are divided into regions. The first 7 vertebrae are the cervical vertebrae, C1 to C7. C1 and C2 are special because they are right beneath the cranium, that's the head. C1 is atlas and C2 is axis. They are special in their appearance and their movements. Before we see what's different, first let's quickly recall what a typical vertebra looks like. Here we're looking at it from above. This is anterior and this is posterior. There's a vertebral body, the vertebral arch, and in between the two is the vertebral foramen. The body and the arch are attached by pedicles. From the pedicles, there are sheets of bone called laminae. At the junction of the two laminae extends a spinous process posteriorly. Extending laterally are two transverse processes. Extending above are two superior articular processes, and below are inferior articular processes, better seen from the side. So these are the articular processes. Now we see what's different in atlas and axis. They already look quite different, but let's start with atlas. Atlas is C1, the first cervical vertebra. The most obvious difference here is that it doesn't have a body, and it doesn't have a spinous process. It's more like a ring. Instead of a body, it's got these two lateral masses. From each lateral mass, there is a transverse process. Each transverse process has that foramen transversarium because these are cervical vertebrae that allows the vertebral vessels to pass through it. Because of that lateral mass, the transverse processes are placed further away than the typical cervical vertebrae, making this one the widest of the cervical vertebrae. Now we're looking at it from above, so these two facets would be the superior articular processes. Now all vertebrae have that, to articulate with the inferior articular processes of the vertebra above it. But what's above atlas? The cranium. So if we flip the cranium upside down, this would be the foramen magnum from where the spinal cord is going to emerge. This bone is the occipital bone, and on either side of foramen magnum are condyles called the occipital condyles. That's what the superior articular processes of atlas articulate with. Together, they form a joint called the atlanto-occipital joint, and I'll get to that. But let's complete atlas. It's got an anterior arch and a posterior arch, which unite in the midline by an anterior tubercle and a posterior tubercle. Thus, we have a ring-shaped bone. Below atlas sits axis. Axis kind of looks more like your typical cervical vertebra. It has a body, it has a spinous process, which is bifid, as most cervical vertebrae are. It too has those transverse foramina. Its inferior articular processes would articulate with the superior articular processes of C3. And what's above it? C1, that's atlas. The superior articular processes of axis articulate with the inferior processes of atlas. But what's obviously different about axis is that the body extends upwards as a blunt projection that's called the dens or the odontoid process because it looks like a tooth. So axis has the dens, and that dens is going to fit behind the anterior arch of atlas. So the dens is posterior to the anterior arch of atlas. Here we're looking at it from behind, but from above we just see the top of the dens. The spinal cord, after exiting the foramen magnum, would continue through this vertebral foramen of atlas. The dens, together with the spinal cord, are thus encircled by that ring-shaped atlas. The lateral masses of atlas have inferior articular processes, which articulate with the superior articular facets of axis. That creates two different kinds of joints. One in the middle, between the dens and the anterior arch of atlas, and two on the sides, between the articular processes. These are between atlas and axis, so they are the atlantoaxial joints. One median atlantoaxial joint and two lateral atlantoaxial joints. Now we're going to get a little creative. This is something I do when I make notes in anatomy because drawing in anatomy is challenging. But we don't need to draw complicated things. That's what we use anatomy atlases for. Let's assume this is the dens. It sits behind the anterior arch of atlas. Then there are the articular processes of atlas and axis forming joints on the sides. That will make this the median atlantoaxial joint, and these two the lateral atlantoaxial joints. Now we'll add in the atlanto-occipital joints. Together, all these joints form the craniovertebral joints. They are needed for the movement of the head with the neck, as in nodding up and down in a yes and shaking your head from side to side in a no. Between vertebrae of the vertebral column, there is usually an intervertebral disc, but here between these two vertebrae, there is no intervertebral disc. These joints are synovial joints because they are movable. The atlanto-occipital joint is a condyloid joint. Pretty straightforward with those occipital condyles. Condyloid joint. Its main movement is flexion and extension. That would be nodding in a yes. Also a little side tilt of the head. The atlanto-axial joints are different. The lateral ones are gliding joints, but the median one with the dens is a pivot joint. That's because atlas carrying the cranium rotates on axis. That's how the head moves side to side in a knot. Atlas carries the cranium. Atlas carries the cranium. That's a reference to Greek mythology of Atlas carrying the weight of the world on his shoulders. Our heads are that weight. But when I read about it, it turns out Atlas actually carried the sky and not the world. But that's not important to us right now. Atlas carries the cranium. That dens is held in place against the anterior arch of Atlas by a ligament that goes across from one lateral mass of Atlas to the other. That is the transverse ligament of Atlas. It separates the dens from the spinal cord. Let's put Atlas and axis beneath the cranium. So we're looking at the top of the head, and we can see through it. This is anterior, so we'll draw in a little nose. This is the midline, an axis that goes through axis the bone. So when the head rotates to one side, how does it do that? Atlas carries the cranium and pivots on axis. Now the head has turned, but axis stays where it is. They pivot. Around axis. Axis is literally the axis for the two to pivot on. And that's how we say no. Now let's look at some ligaments that keeps all these joints stable. Drawing that kind of stuff is quite difficult, so I'm just going to help you remember some of the names. Assume this is atlas and axis, and we're looking at them from behind. There's that spinous process. Atlas articulates with the occipital bone. Just gonna draw a little arch here to represent that. The first few ligaments are actually gonna be inside this ring. So remember what goes behind the dens from one lateral mass to the other of Atlas, the transverse ligament of Atlas. It is strong, but it has two weaker bands that extend above and below. The superior longitudinal band is gonna go and attach to the occipital bone, the inferior one to the body of Axis. If we put these three together, that's going to form the cruciate ligament of Atlas. Let's remove some of these now. From the dens extending laterally to the margins of foramen magnum on the occipital bone are the alar ligaments. So we've done the cruciate ligament and the alar ligament. There's also an apical ligament of dens extending from the apex of the dens to the anterior edge of foramen magnum. In addition to these, there is an anterior atlanto-occipital membrane and an anterior atlanto-axial membrane. If you look at the names, you'll know what they connect and attach to. Atlas to the occipital bone, atlas to axis. Now these are actually a continuation of a ligament that comes from the rest of the column, the anterior longitudinal ligament. Let's declutter this screen a little. So these were on the anterior aspect. Just like that, there are posterior atlanto-occipital and posterior atlanto-axial membranes on the posterior aspect. To understand what these are, we need some of the other vertebrae. Now I'll be talking about ligaments in the rest of the vertebral column in the next part, but assume that these are hemisections of more typical vertebrae lower down. That's one half of a vertebra where I've drawn the body, lamina, and a spinous process. Body, spinous process, lamina. So the anterior longitudinal ligament would form these two, but the posterior longitudinal ligament goes along the posterior surface of the vertebral bodies and continues up. Between the laminae is a ligamentum flavum. This is what these two are modifications of. So the anterior membranes are continuations of the anterior longitudinal ligaments, and the posterior ones are modifications of the ligamenta flava. All these ligaments are meant to prevent excessive movements at the joints. Hopefully, when you look at an anatomy atlas and you're a little lost, this may help, but this is how I doodle and scribble out my notes in anatomy. So those are some things about the bones, ligaments, and joints of the top two cervical vertebrae, atlas and axis. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.